गुड मॉर्निंग शानी। ऑलराइट, सो गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन। आई हैव जस्ट स्टार्टेड रिकॉर्डिंग। ओके, सो आर देयर एनी क्वेश्चंस पर्टेनिंग टू व्हाट वी हैव डिस्कस्ड सो फार? Okay, if not, the goal today is to complete the proof of Brooks' theorem, and we won't go any further than that today because there's going to be a week-long break, so I don't want to have too much discontinuity. Okay, so we are trying to work towards a proof of Brooks' theorem, right? I'm just trying to give you the intuition at this point, okay? And one of the things we noticed at the end of last lecture is that if you take a spanning tree of a connected graph and you construct an ordering using that spanning tree by removing leaves at each step, okay, then you can get an ordering which will require delta g plus one colors, but only the last vertex might want to use the last color. So all the other vertices except the root vertex of your spanning tree, all other vertices will use one of the colors from 1, 2 up to delta G, right? Let me just say delta. So all of these vertices will use one of these first delta colors, and the last vertex might need the last color, delta plus 1. Okay? Good. So that was the observation, and I'm just illustrating that here. So you have a graph G. I mean, it's a very small example. And you have a spanning tree, as I've shown here. Then you could construct an ordering like U, V, W, followed by R. Right? I'm removing a leaf at each step. And R is my root vertex. Okay? And if you do that, then if you color according to this coloring, you would get color 1. Then you would go to vertex V. V has neighbors U, R, and W in the graph. U is already colored with 1, so we can take color 2. W has neighbors U and V. They are using color, sorry, W has neighbors U and V. Sorry, U is not a neighbor of W, my bad. So W could use color 1. And then the root vertex cannot use either of the two colors, 1 and 2, so it will use the color 3. So in this particular example, we just use delta colors. We did not even need delta plus 1 colors. Okay, but in general, you could require the last color for the last vertex because it could have degree delta, and then all the neighbors could be using a different color, and so you may need to use the last color. Fair enough. But until you reach the last vertex, you will never need that color because every time you color a vertex, there is an uncolored neighbor, the parent of that vertex in the tree. Right? So that's why for all the other vertices, you will not require the color delta plus 1. Okay? Good. Great. So this is a good observation because it's going to help us. This idea of using a spanning tree to get an ordering and then applying the greedy coloring heuristic is going to help us in proving Brooks' theorem. Okay? So, I want to ask you the question. I want to ask you the following question. Maybe if my spanning tree has some special properties, I don't need to use delta plus one colors. Maybe I can use just delta colors. So, what special property of the spanning tree could help us in using just delta G colors? Of course, It won't be true for all graphs. Maybe all graphs, all connected graphs won't have such a spanning tree. In fact, they should not, because the complete graphs and the odd cycles require delta plus one colors. So whatever special property we are looking for, the complete graphs and odd cycles are not going to have that. Right? Let's just make that clear in the very beginning. Oh, graph is not regular. That's great. Okay. So you're not giving me a property of the tree, but you're telling me that if the graph is not regular, then you could just use delta G color. So let's take this up. Let's come back to this later. In the meanwhile, what if G is not regular? In this case, can we actually take minimum degree as root? Great. Okay. Thanks. So you guys have answered the next question. So if the graph is not regular, then actually you can just use delta G colors, because you would take a vertex that does not have maximum degree. Okay. And so there is some vertex V whose degree is less than delta. You would make that as the root of your spanning tree. Okay. And this way you will not need the last color, because when you come to the root, it has less than delta neighbors. So they will use less than delta colors. So the last color will be available for the root vertex. Okay. So consider a spanning tree T of G rooted at some vertex R that is such that the degree of V, degree of R is less than the maximum degree, right? Because the graph is not regular, there is going to be some vertex whose degree is not maximum. And now construct ordering, which I have written here. You take the remove a leaf at each step. Okay. And apply greedy heuristic. Okay. This requires at most delta G colors. Is everybody convinced that you will not require the last color in this case? So in fact, what we have done is we have proved Brooks' theorem for all graphs that are not regular. And of course, odd cycles and complete graphs happen to be regular, right? So in fact, for graphs that are not regular, delta G colors always suffice. Great. Okay. So this is good. We did not use any property of the spanning tree, except for the fact that we chose a root, which is not a vertex of maximum degree. Right? Okay, great. So this means that we only need to prove Brooks' theorem now for regular graphs. Okay. So now maybe there is something else we can do for all regular graphs except the complete graphs and odd cycles. And we can still manage to use only delta G colors. Okay. So in this case, what we are going to do is we are going to show that there is a spanning tree with a certain special property. Okay. Well, basically what we want is when we are coloring the graph using the spanning tree idea. So let's say this is our tree. Okay, something like this. When we get to this vertex, the root, we want that two of the neighbors of the root are using the same color. If two neighbors are using the same color, then we would be done, right? Okay, so if we can somehow ensure that two neighbors of the root use the same color as per our greedy coloring, then we'll be happy. Turns out we can actually show something much stronger. What we will show, there is a small caveat that I will come to. What we will show is that there is always a spanning tree that looks like this. There are two leaves of the root, and the rest of the graph looks like rest of the tree is something arbitrary. I don't care about it. What we will show is that there is always a spanning tree that looks like this. These two are leaves. And they are not adjacent in the graph G. Okay? So if I can convince you that every graph except odd cycles and complete graphs has a spanning tree with this property, then we would be done. Unfortunately, this is not true. You can take a path, and in a path, you will not be able to find such a spanning tree. I'll give you a bit more detailed explanation in a few seconds. But we will prove that this is actually true for two connected graphs. So, one of our goals is to show that every two connected graph has a spanning tree with this property. Okay. Great. We will still need to deal with graphs that are not too connected. Don't worry. When we get to that, we will use the fact that regular graphs, graphs that are not regular, Brooks' theorem is true. So we will use that to deal with the graphs that are not too connected. Okay. But let's stick with this for a few seconds. In fact, notice that this is the same as saying that the graph G desired property. So let me just call this Brooks, just for the sake of this lecture, let me call this a Brooks cherry. Okay, so what is a Brooks cherry? It is a subgraph that looks like this. It is an induced subgraph that looks like this, which means that this is not an edge in the graph. Okay, so a subgraph, it is an induced subgraph H of the graph G. That is isomorphic to K1, comma 2. So this is K1, 2, right? Such that when I delete the leaves of this H, I get a connected graph. So in this example, well, in this drawing, you can think of this as R. You can think of these as the leaves of H. So this is our graph H. Okay. When I delete the vertices U and V, G minus U minus V, I want a connected graph. If I can prove to you that every two connected graph except complete graphs and odd cycles has a Brooks cherry, which means it's an induced subgraph that looks like K12. That's in the camera. It looks like K12. So that when I delete these two vertices, my remaining graph is still connected. And because this is an induced subgraph, it means that this edge is not in the graph. Okay? So these two vertices, they can receive the same color in our coloring. Okay? So this goal here is the same as to show that each two connected graph G that is not a complete graph or a cycle. Actually, even cycles do not have a Brooks cherry, but even cycles are too colorable. We don't care about them, right? So we have already proved Brooks theorem for even cycles. Okay, so if it is not a complete graph or a cycle, then it has a Brooks cherry. So I can find a subgraph with these properties, and then I can easily construct the spanning tree because I just delete the two vertices u and v. My graph is still connected. And I take a spanning tree of the remaining graph, and I put u and v as leaves of the tree and join them to the root. Okay? Is it clear why these two things are the same? Having a spanning tree with these property with this property is the same as saying that the graph is a Brooks cherry. Okay? And I'm using the term Brooks cherry just so that I don't have to always say the whole definition. Plus, it's cute. Okay. U and V are leaves in G. No, G is not a tree. They are leaves in our tree. So we are constructing a spanning tree where these two vertices will be leaves of the tree. But G could be a five connected graph. So there is no there could be no leaves in the graph G. Does that answer your question? What if u and v are connected to a fourth vertex? That's not a problem. I am not restricting u and v being connected to other vertices. What I want is they are not adjacent with each other. So they could be connected to other vertices. Yeah? Okay, thanks. Just to be clear, induced subgraph here just means that UV is not an edge of the graph. Okay? Great. All right, so we will show this for two connected graphs. What about graphs that are not two connected? Well, let's first finish those graphs. So, graphs that are not two connected. Okay. Here we will use the fact that graphs that are not regular, Brooks' theorem is already true, right? They need at most delta G colors. So, supposing I have a connected graph G, and we can assume that it's regular. So, let's say connected graph G, and V is the cut vertex. Okay? If G is not regular, then chromatic number of the graph is at most delta G, and we are done. Now suppose that G is regular. Okay? So we have a regular graph, we have a cut vertex. So the graph looks like this, right? We can write the graph as G equal to G1 union G2, such that the intersection of these two graphs is exactly the vertex V. Okay. Now, because the graph G is regular, I claim that G1 and G2 are not regular. Since G is regular, this implies that G1 and G2 are not regular. Is everybody convinced of that? The vertex V does not have the same degree as any other vertex in G1 or in G2. Okay, so that means that because these are not regular graphs, G1 admits a delta G1 vertex coloring proper. And likewise, G2 also admits a delta G2 proper coloring, right? Okay, and notice that delta GI is less than or equal to delta G. So they both admit delta colorings. But now I can just combine those colorings because I can make sure that the vertex V, supposing the vertex V receives color red here, then I can just relabel the colors and make sure that the vertex V receives red color here as well. Okay, that's clear, right? I can just swap the colors and make sure that vertex V is colored red. And now if I combine the two colorings, I get a coloring of the whole graph with delta G colors, where vertex V is colored red again. Okay, so combine the two colorings to get a proper delta G vertex coloring of G. Okay, so this proves that for any graph that is not too connected, delta G colors will suffice. Okay. Okay, so this proves Brooks' theorem for graphs that are not too connected. Now we go back to our main goal, right? So this is a bit of a side. We need to deal with them, but they are not particularly interesting. Okay, so now let's go to two connected graphs. Brooks' theorem for two connected graphs. Okay, and the goal here is to show that there is always a Brooks cherry, unless your graph is a complete graph or it is a cycle. Okay. And we won't use the fact that the graph is regular. Turns out that the proof actually does not, the remaining proof does not require the fact that the graph is regular. So it works for all graphs that are two connected. Okay. Of course, you can use it if you find a use for it, but turns out you are better off without that. So now, G is to prove Brooks' theorem. For two connected graphs. Before we embark on this exciting journey, are there any questions? Any questions regarding anything we discussed so far? This is really a good point to ask questions. Okay, if not, then let's proceed. So G is our two connected graph and we will assume that G is not a cycle and it is not a complete graph. Okay. What else? Maybe that's not the best notation, but anyways, you get the point. It's not in the family of cycles and in the family of complete graphs. Okay. And our goal, which will prove Brooks' theorem, is to show that G has a Brooks cherry. This will imply that the chromatic number of this graph is at most the maximum degree of this graph. Okay. So we just want to show that there is a subgraph H, that it's an induced subgraph and it's isomorphic to K12. Okay. So you can think of R as the degree 2 vertex and U and V as the degree 1 vertices in H. Induced means that U and V are not adjacent. And the other property of Brooks' cherry is that when we delete the vertices U and V from the graph G, we want a connected graph. Okay. Great. All right. So now, turns out we are going to use a bunch of things from your assignment too. Okay. Okay. So, proof of this fact that there is a Brooks cherry. Okay. So first of all, since the graph is not a cycle, there is a vertex of degree at least 3. Since G is not a cycle, G has a vertex of degree at least 3. Also, as you remember, throughout we are considering only simple graphs. We don't care about graphs that are not simple. So let me just add simple here for the sake of completeness. Okay. So there is a vertex of degree at least 3 because there is an near decomposition. You start with a cycle, you add an year, you get a vertex of degree 3. Right? Good. Great. So now there are going to be two cases. Either every vertex of degree at least 3 is universal or not. Okay, so let's look at these two cases. Case one is every vertex of degree at least 3 is universal. And case two is there exists a vertex of degree at least 3. That is not universal. Okay, these are our two cases. Well, every vertex of degree at least 3 is universal is something you did on your assignment 2, and you showed that either the graph is a cycle or it's a complete graph or it's a graph K2, N where you join the two vertices in the smaller color class. Okay, so we already know our graph is not a cycle, it's not a complete graph. So in case one, by assignment two, I don't remember the problem number. You can look it up. We know that the graph looks like this. It's K2, N plus one edge as follows. So you have this graph. This is the smallest graph. Then you have this graph. And so on, right? And in all of these graphs, there is a Brooks cherry. Does everybody see a Brooks cherry in these graphs? Right? This is a Brooks cherry, RUV, right? And it exists in all the graphs in this family. Okay, so these graphs are done. You have a Brooks cherry, so you can get your spanning tree that looked like what I had drawn here. And now you do the greedy coloring and you will be done in delta colors. You start with U and V and then you color the remaining graph as per the greedy coloring. Okay. Good. So now we need to deal with case two, which says that there exists a vertex of degree at least three that is not universal. Okay, great. So let's say let X be a vertex of degree at least three that is not universal. Okay, good. So as you can see, connectivity is playing an important role in this proof so far. We dealt with graphs that are not two connected, and now we are dealing with two connected graphs. Turns out we can do the same again. You delete the graph, you delete the vertex X, and now either the remaining graph is two connected or it is not. And we will look at those two cases separately. So case 2.1 is that G minus X is two connected. Okay, so let's look at this case first. Supposing I delete this vertex and the remaining graph is two connected. Okay, then I claim that we can find a Brooks cherry by just doing some local inspection. Okay, let's make a picture. So X is our vertex. This is the remaining graph, G minus X. This is a two connected graph. And what we know is that X has degree at least three, but it is not universal. So let's look at the neighborhood of X. Supposing this is the neighborhood of X. Okay. So by that, I mean all vertices that are neighbors of X, that are joined to X by an edge. Okay? Well, X has degree at least three, so there are going to be at least three vertices here. But X is not a universal vertex. That means that this part is non-empty, right? I want to find a Brooks cherry. Can somebody help me? How are we going to find a Brooks cherry in this picture? We are going to find it locally. So we are going to use the vertex X. That is a hint I'm already giving you. Anyone? Yeah, go ahead, Ravi.
So since the graph is connected, the neighborhood of X should be connected to this part. The
remaining part.
Yeah, remaining part. So like there must be a path from X to some vertex here, and then we can choose the vertex in the neighborhood of X to be the center vertex X.
Exactly. Great. So that's exactly what we are going to do. I'm not even going to write down all the details. There has to be some neighbor. There has to be some vertex here, which is connected to the neighborhood of X because the graph is connected. Okay. And now, observe that we have our cherry. Think of this as the root, the center of the cherry. This is X, and this is another vertex, let's say W. Right? So now you have R, X, and W. X and W are not connected in the graph G, clearly, because W is not a neighbor of X. Right? And G minus X minus W is connected because G minus X is two connected by assumption. Okay, so we have all the properties we want. We have an induced K12. When you delete the leaves X and W, the graph G is still connected. Great. Okay, so this case is done. And now we come to the next case. G minus X is not too connected. Okay, so we have a two connected graph, and when we delete a vertex, the graph is not two connected anymore, right? So we again go to assignment 2, where we proved a few things about such situations. Okay, so the graph G minus X has a block decomposition. Okay, let's make some drawing. I don't know. Maybe this is one block. This is another block. Then you have yet another block. Something like this. Okay. And I have deleted a vertex X. So as per your assignment, we are going to again apply things we did in assignment 2. Well, there are going to be at least 2 end blocks in G minus X. Okay. And X is going to have a neighbor in each end block, a neighbor that is an internal vertex of that end block. So let me just write down G minus X has at least 2 end blocks, say H1 and H2. Also, if H is an end block of G minus X, then X has a neighbor. X has a neighbor that is an internal vertex of H. Just to remind you, internal vertices are those vertices of H that are not cut vertices of the graph G. Okay? So if this is an end block H1 in our figure, then these are the then this vertex, for example, is not an internal vertex because it is a cut vertex of the graph, right? So in particular, X has to have a neighbor that is an internal vertex of H1. And likewise, it has to have a neighbor that is an internal vertex of some other block H2. There is another end block here, H3, in my drawing. So X also has a neighbor there. Okay, something like this. Great. Now, can someone help me find the cherry? Can we find the cherry? Does anybody see a Brooks cherry? No. Okay. Well, what if we take a neighbor of X that is an internal vertex of H1, let's say U, and another neighbor of X that is an internal vertex of H2, let's say V? Does this work? What about the graph XUV? I claim that This is a cherry. This is a Brooks cherry. Notice that we are deleting vertices. Well, first of all, clearly it is K12, and U and V are not adjacent in the graph, right? Because they are internal vertices of two distinct blocks. So there is no edge between them. Okay, otherwise you would contradict the block decomposition definition. Okay, so they are not connected in the graph G. Okay, and if you delete both U and V, well, these are internal vertices in the blocks. The block is a two connected graph. When you delete an internal vertex from the block is still connected, right? And the cut vertices of that block still connect the block to the remaining graph. Okay, so by deleting an internal vertex from the two blocks, you are not going to disconnect the graph G minus X. What I'm saying is that G minus X minus U minus V is connected. And now I want to claim that G minus U minus V is connected. Can someone tell me why this is true? So why is G minus U minus V connected? Why can I reintroduce the vertex X and the graph will still be connected? There is some property of X that we need to use. Anyone? Remember that X is a vertex of degree at least 3. Right, which means X has some neighbor that is not U or V. Supposing the graph has only two end blocks, H1 and H2. But then, even then, X will have some vertex, X will have some neighbor that is not U or V because X has degree at least 3. So there is some vertex in G minus X minus U minus V that is a neighbor of X. So when you put the vertex X back in, the graph is still connected. Since X has degree at least 3 in G. Okay, so this is our Brooks cherry. So in all cases, we have found a Brooks cherry, and that is the proof. Am I audible?
Yes,
Okay, good. So, are there any questions? Okay, so is it clear what we are doing? We first proved the theorem for graphs that are not two connected. There we use the fact that the theorem is already true for graphs that are not regular, right? That was easy to prove. Right? And once we dealt with those graphs that are not two connected, we went on to two connected graphs, right? And in this case, what we showed is that the graph always has a Brooks cherry. Okay? You need to get rid of the graphs that are not two connected. Otherwise, there are graphs that are like paths which don't have Brooks cherry. Okay. Of course, there could be other ways to prove it, but at least in this particular approach, you need to separate out the graphs that are not two connected. But once you are in the class of two connected graphs, it turns out that all graphs except cycles and complete graphs, they have a Brooks cherry. So you can get a spanning tree. You can get a spanning tree that looks like this, right? And if you have a spanning tree that looks like this, you can color the graph with delta colors. Okay. So that's it. And this proof that we did is due to LOAS. So maybe I should due to Laszlo LOAS. Some of you may have heard that he was awarded the Abel Prize along with Avi Vigdorsson, who works in complexity theory. And Laszlo LOAS has done work in various areas of mathematics, but especially combinatorics and graph theory. This is from the 60s or 70s. It's, I think, one of the earliest works of LOAS. Okay. So there are many different proofs of Brooks' theorem, but I personally felt that this was one which seemed most appealing to me. It really made it clear what was a property of all graphs except complete graphs and odd cycles that made Brooks' theorem work, right? And that property is indeed having a Brooks cherry. Good. So that's all for now. I haven't yet decided whether we are going to do more things in colorings, vertex colorings. I am inclined to do a few more things in vertex colorings, but I'm going to spend the break to figure out the second half of the course. So you can think of this as sort of an end of the first half of the course. Although vertex colorings, we might still continue after the break. I am thinking of finishing vertex colorings, moving on to edge colorings, and then moving on to matchings, because matchings is my own area of research. So if I have 3 weeks to cover matchings, then that should be fine. And I might be able to cover some extra material as well, which I did not originally plan to have on the course. So I might first finish vertex and edge colorings and then keep matchings as the last module of the course. But I haven't yet made a decision. In the text, matchings comes before edge colorings. All right.
So I was just curious, how many assignments are you planning to have after the third one?
Good point. I haven't yet decided, to be honest. How many would you guys like? 2 or 3? Is 3 too many? Okay. Maybe, well, at least 2, as is clear to you from my answer. I might even consider having 3, but I'm not sure yet. Let's see. I want to have 3 assignments. I might have either 2 long assignments, long as in similar to length as assignment number 3, planarity, or 3 short assignments. Slightly shorter, although none of my assignments are really very short. So I'm not too sure yet, but I'm not planning to have another writing exercise, if that gives you some relief. Fair enough. Any other questions or concerns? So when are the midterm exams for your courses coming up?
So most have happened actually. Like for other courses, it is. I'm not taking any courses midterms. So.
Oh, I see. Okay.
We have a midterm, which is basically like an assignment, so 2 weeks. Yeah, it's
okay.
Take home exam.
Right. I see. Interesting. And in the beginning, one of you had mentioned about going for some internship or something. Can you remind me of that again?
Yes, sir. Arnav and I have to go, but I don't think that should intervene with anything. Like 7th of May is the last. Like if it's till then we don't have any problem. We shouldn't have any problem.
7th of May is the last what?
according to the institute calendar, 7th of May is the last class.
I see. Okay, good. That's good to know. Okay. So that means that we have another how many weeks remaining for the course? Lecture weeks?
5 weeks, I think.
5 weeks.
Right, 4 weeks.
Okay. So maybe... I see. So I think 2 assignments should be probably enough. There is some chance that I give you 3 assignments, but I'm leaning more towards 2 now, given that we only have essentially 1.5 months of the course remaining. Yeah?
Yes.
Okay. Great. I'll stop recording, but if you have any other questions or concerns, feel free to stay and ask them.